Presenting History's Best on PBS. Tonight on People's Century, 1933, the promise of an ideal race. Smarter, healthier, more prosperous, Aryan. But others are cast as inferior, not worthy of happiness, freedom, or even life. Master Race, just one in a series of extraordinary films that explores our century. People's Century, tonight.
Brought to you by Conseco, where we believe that leaping at certain financial opportunities can make a secure financial future harder to grasp. Conseco, our goal is to help you protect wealth, create wealth for life.
Major funding for People's Century was provided by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and the annual financial support of viewers like you. Additional funding was provided by the Lowell Institute.
Berlin, 1933. The National Socialists come to power, and the German people take the first steps down a new road. They will be asked to put their trust in a set of ideas based on race, military strength, and authoritarian government.
A sea of swastikas. We were out in the streets and went to the Brandenburg Gate. Watch the Nazis marching into power. Restaurants were open almost all night. People were drinking. There was a huge commotion. We were shocked by this incredible upsurge and the sudden swing to the Nazis.
Millions of ordinary Germans allow themselves to be persuaded that they are a special people with a special destiny. And they are drawn into a horror unique in the history of civilization. The Nazis rode to power through the strong leadership of one man. Adolf Hitler had never won an election. He became chancellor through a political deal. He blamed Germany's problems on her unjust treatment by the Allies after the First World War, and on weak German politicians in the Depression years that followed. Now the days of party politics were over. He would embody the national will.
Heute weiß es das ganze Volk, unser Wille war härter als die deutsche Not. Nach 15-jähriger Verzweiflung hat ein großes Volk wieder Tritt gefasst.
Germans attracted by the promise of a more orderly and united society had to accept his methods. He took total power immediately and put political opponents into concentration camps. The Nazis burnt books by left-wingers and Jewish intellectuals. Many Germans were socialists or communists, but to the Nazis, these were dangerous ideologies to be purged. There was to be no more industrial conflict. Trade unions were banned, and all workers had to join a Nazi labor front. During the Depression, unemployment had reached 30%. Now industry revived as Hitler strove to rearm Germany and give every German worker a job. The party gathered support in every factory. In town and country. Help was sent to the farmers, many driven bankrupt in the Depression. All over Germany, people were swept into massive demonstrations of party unity. Harvest Festival was staged as a grand celebration. A mixture of new ideas and revived old customs.
The thousands of people you can see all around were farmers, young people from all over Germany. We traveled in special trains and then marched for hours to get as close to the front as possible. I was right at the front. We all felt the same, happiness and joy. Harvest Festival was the thank you for us farmers having a future again. Things were looking up. I believe no statesman has ever been as loved as Adolf Hitler was then. It's all come flooding back to me. Those were happy times.
To give work to the unemployed, Hitler launched huge public works projects. Two and a half thousand miles of Autobahn were announced, linking major cities.
Das neue deutsche Reichsautostraßennetz ist nicht nur in der Anlage das gewaltigste, was es diese Art auf der Welt gibt. Da können diese Menschen hergehen und im Ausland dann ihre dummen Zeitungsartikel herunterlesen, in denen sie zusammen schmieren, was sie an Lügen erfinden können. Am Ende einmal kommt doch der und jener, der kommt nach Deutschland und da muss er sagen, Herrgott, was für einen Judenschwindel haben wir die ganze Zeit jetzt gelesen. Es ist ja ganz anders.
Ich habe dann auch als einer der ersten, also
I was one of the first radio reporters to drive on the Autobahn. There were thousands and thousands of people watching with great excitement.
Tausende von Menschen in einer jubelnden Begeisterung. Ich habe das natürlich auch klar.
Of course, I reported that it was a great achievement, which we should be proud of, and which would be repeated.
Dass das eben auch so weitergehen wird, ja.
In the propaganda, the road builders were held up as an example of National Socialism in action.
For a long time, we believed everything that came over the radio. The young people were the most excited by the propaganda. Over 90% of us were behind everything that went on.
Über 90% dahinter.
Meine Damen und Herren, in der heutigen Sitzung des Reichskabinetts.
To make sure every family could get the message, cheap radios were mass-produced. State radio put across one idea above all else.
In a word, the greatness of the German people. Propaganda gave people a big boost in confidence for the first time.
Das eine gehört zum anderen. Eine gute Regierung ohne Propaganda kann ebenso wenig bestehen wie eine gute Propaganda ohne eine gute Regierung.
One way to build national unity was to blame Germany's problems on the Jews.
Und wenn die jüdischen Zeitungen heute glauben, auf versteckte Drohungen die nationalsozialistische Bewegung einschüchtern zu können, sie sollen sich hüten. Einmal wird unsere Geduld zu Ende sein und dann wird den Juden das freche Lügenmaul gestopft werden.
The Nazis drew on old hatreds, old jealousies towards the Jews.
They were much slyer in business than the normal German and Austrian, and they were so excellent in literature and in theaters. And in cinema, and in science. More than 50% of the medicine doctors in Vienna were Jews, more than 70% of the lawyers. And of course, all that made for a strong and hardliner anti-Semitism.
Of Germany's 500,000 Jews, only a minority were ultra-Orthodox. The Bodenheimer family in a Berlin suburb saw themselves first and foremost as Germans.
Als er ihn sich abgerungen, hat ihn bald die Welt gesungen.
Er wurde vom Bulle.
Die Geister, die er rief, die wird er nicht mehr los.
Denn jeden Abend singt jetzt seine alte Blues.
This is my brother Edgar and I. We were very, very close. These are my parents. In the garden. My father was a banker. I put the cigar in his mouth. I enjoyed it when he smoked. I was in my family the only person who looked Jewish, and Germans were very aware of how people looked and were very attuned to discovering a Jew. I remember as a little girl walking somewheres and some stranger would pass me and say, "Dirty Jew."
In April 1933, Hitler and Goebbels ordered a nationwide boycott of Jewish-owned businesses. Most Germans stood by and watched as shops were picketed and defaced.
It was a frightening experience, it was a shock, and my mother was the one who said, "We must leave Germany." And almost to the day, a year later, we were all out, had officially emigrated. I still admire her for her guts and her gut feelings, and I think we were very lucky.
The Nazis created a historical myth to support their ideas.
P
Purebred Germans were naturally superior because they were the descendants of noble medieval knights from a less degenerate age of verdant forests and Aryan blood. Germans were told their ancestors had been a uniquely advanced, cultured race. Cooperative archaeologists dug up bogus relics as evidence.
Deutsche Mutter Erde tut sich auf, um Kunde zu geben von der hohen Kulturstufe unserer frühesten Vorfahren.
The successors of the Teutonic Knights were the men of the elite SS.
I personally was in the SS. Racial, Nordic, selected people, and we shall be the future aristocratic spine bone of the German nation. Well, I thought, wonderful, no? And I felt myself very much flattered by being chosen for this, and then the uniform was very beautiful, black, no? Of course we liked the uniform and the boots and all that, no?
The SS had begun as Hitler's bodyguards. Now they became the spearhead in the drive to confirm the German people as the master race.
So sind wir angetreten und marschieren nach unabänderlichen Gesetzen. Wir gehen den Weg in eine ferne Zukunft und wünschen und glauben, wir möchten nicht nur sein die Enkel, die es besser ausfochten, sondern darüber hinaus die Ahnen spätester für das ewige Leben des deutschen und germanischen Volkes notwendiger Geschlechter.
SS-Leader Himmler asked Germans to follow Nazi genetic theories and improve the racial stock. The state gave loans to encourage healthy couples to have more children. For unusually productive mothers, there were medals. The ideal baby was racially pure and genetically fit, so partners had to be chosen with great care.
I was affected by this when I married. I had to prove myself as an SS officer, all my ancestors down to 1750. And my wife, she had to fill out about 22 questions, whether she likes too much dresses or perfumes. We thought that we can form a new ideal race. And that we thought perfect. And I chose my wife according to this line.
The new German was self-disciplined and healthy, a model many aspired to. As a young woman, Luisa Essig worked as an education officer for the Nazi farming ministry. She had to put the theory into practice among the farmers. She developed a training program that linked fitness and rural crafts with racial purity and the sanctity of the soil. The project was called Faith and Beauty, and thousands of young people learned it from Luisa.
I developed farming study groups, and we had sports and so on. I took my suggestions to Berlin, and they were all accepted. And so the Faith and Beauty Scheme for Girls was launched. And in the countryside, we set up these two groups studying the farming profession and rural lifestyles.
A whole generation was taught to live the ideal German life the Nazis prescribed. Local party officials regularly reminded them what it was all for.
For Führer and Fatherland, that's what it was usually about. We're fighting for Führer and Fatherland, something like that.
The generation that grew up together in the small village of Repner in Lower Saxony watches a film made there in the 30s at a May Day festival.
The 1st of May, I was 6. The flag's being hoisted. That's the pastor's house with the stork's nest on top. And the maypole being put up. There's the Young Girls League and the boys in the Hitler Youth. They've put up a swastika. I like wearing the Young Girls uniform and loved the Hitler Youth organization. I really liked it.
There I am on the float playing Hansel.
My brother and I are Hansel and Gretel and Lottie's the witch. Blonde, blue-eyed, tall people were much admired. They were the flag carriers, as you can see. Ilsa carried the flag because she was pretty, tall and blonde. There I am. I'm carrying the flag. I was very proud to carry the flag. My main thought was that I'd be in the film. We weren't really swept along. We took part because everybody did. We didn't want to be left behind, so we went along with it.
But not every German could be part of this shared national folk experience. The belief which held up the purebred Aryan as the ideal German condemned Jewish people as an inferior race. Jewish children were ejected from the state education system, forcing Jewish communities to set up their own schools. Between 1933 and 1935, a succession of decrees banned Jews from law, medicine, and civil service, pushing them out of the Aryan workplace and the Aryan home.
I went to art school in Berlin, and we knew we weren't allowed to go out with German girls. I didn't have any German girlfriends because of the Nuremberg laws.
In Aryan classrooms, children were taught to be on their guard against Jews. But first, they had to be able to spot them. Children's books like The Poisonous Mushroom were designed to help. Jews were like the death cap. They had to be picked out from the other harmless mushrooms in the forest of life. Books taught how to recognize the Jew, the molester of children, the ravisher of Aryan women, the swindler of honest Germans. The message was to get rid of them. The Jews are not wanted. And this sign was not part of a fairy tale. It was put up across Germany in the late 30s. Jews are not wanted here.
It was a process which developed slowly but surely and took over whole sections of the population who had never thought about it before. A lot of them just talked about it, not necessarily believing it. But gradually their brains became fogged, and they started to say, the Jews are our misfortune.
Der berühmte Satz, die Juden sind unser Unglück.
Other groups that didn't fit in with the racial ideas of the state found themselves under pressure. In 1936, there were 45,000 gypsies in Germany holding on to their traditional itinerant way of life. Members of the Ernst family were Romani musicians. Anna Maria remembers the gypsy's life on the road.
It was a beautiful life, wonderful, happy. There were celebrations, dancing. The women were full of vitality, marriages were arranged. We had real gypsy weddings which lasted for 6 or 7 days. They loved living life as free as a bird in the sky.
To Nazi eyes, the gypsies were a dirty and antisocial nuisance. They accosted decent Germans in the street. They were beggars. Something would have to be done about them. Researchers went out into the field, compiling family trees, measuring the gypsies, pinning them down. Jews, gypsies, homosexuals, and blacks were graded into categories. Records were made on the basis of eye and hair color, cranium size, ancestry. Officials put it all on file, noting where they lived.
So everybody had to sell caravans and belongings and move into flats. We were all made to settle down permanently and register. The wonderful life was over.
The mentally ill were also said to be a danger. They threatened the genetic health of the nation. To keep handicaps from being passed on, the ill were to be forcibly sterilized.
In den letzten 70 Jahren hat sich unser Volk 50% vermehrt, während die Zahl der Erbkranken im gleichen Zeitraum 450% gestiegen ist. Wenn diese Entwicklung so weiterliefe, würde schon in 50 Jahren auf 4 gesunde Menschen ein Erbkranker kommen. Ein endloser Zug des Grauens würde in die Nation hineinmarschieren.
But for those who weren't handicapped, or a gypsy, or a Jew, life was improving by 1937. Germans were regaining their pride as Hitler's aggressive diplomacy forced respect from the rest of Europe. And as the country rearmed, unemployment was cut by 4 million.
Wir sind doch jetzt wieder ein so fleißiges und tatkräftiges Volk geworden. Was schaffen wir jetzt nicht wieder in Deutschland? Und darum bitte ich dich nun, deutsches Volk, darüber gib nun dein Urteil ab. Der Welt unterstelle ich mich nicht. Die kann mich nicht richten.
Now Hitler offered even more. He would bring the German-speaking people of Europe together by expanding the German state. In March 1938, he absorbed Austria in defiance of the Treaty of Versailles, which had forbidden the Union. It was a euphoric moment. Most Austrians supported him. Norbert Lapper was a 19-year-old Viennese Jew.
There had always been anti-Semitism in Vienna and in Austria long before 1938. This was nothing new. But then it became official, and that made it much worse.
In Austria, local Nazis were zealous in devising new insults.
One day, people came and fetched my sister from home. They ordered her to scrub the streets. What was distressing was that people stood there and laughed at them. It was humiliating.
The anti-Jewish campaign was accelerated. In Munich, Nazis pulled down the main synagogue. They said it was a traffic hazard. And then, in 1938, across Germany and Austria, Jews were attacked on November 9th, Kristallnacht, the night of broken glass. Over 1,000 synagogues were burned. 300 Jews were killed. Over 30,000 Jews were rounded up. By January 1939, Hitler had annexed the German-speaking part of Czechoslovakia and was planning for war. But in public, he blamed any possible war on the Jews and linked their fate to it.
Dann wird das Ergebnis nicht die Bolschewisierung der Erde und damit der Sieg des Judentums sein, sondern die Vernichtung der jüdischen Rasse in Europa.
Those who had money and could make the arrangements left the country. Nearly 120,000 Jews emigrated in 1938 and 39 alone. Aryan Germans took over their property and jobs. But it wasn't easy to get away. The lines outside the American consulate in Vienna stretched around the block. Foreign governments limited the number of emigres they would accept. And for those who sought refuge in neighboring countries, escape was short-lived. The Nazis would soon overrun much of Europe. In September 1939, the Second World War began, when the Germans invaded Poland. The Nazis were determined to expand their territory, to provide living space for Aryan Germans. The Germans divided the Poles into racial categories. The blonde, blue-eyed Poles could be turned into Germans. Others could provide slave labor, or be deported, or worse, because over 3 million of them were Jewish. This isn't the Second World War, said Goering. It's the Great Racial War. The trains taking German reinforcements to the front were plastered with slogans. We're off to Poland to bash the Jews. German newsreels reinforced the Nazi line.
Das schwierigste Problem, vor das sich unsere Zivilverwaltung in den besetzten Gebieten gestellt sieht, ist die Judenfrage. Dieses ostjüdische Untermenschentum hat seit jeher Westeuropa das internationale Verbrechergesindel geliefert. Von hier aus wurden die Demokratien mit Taschendieben, Zuhältern, Rauschgift- und Mädchenhändlern, internationalen Bankschiebern und Hetzjournalisten versorgt.
In Germany, the start of the war marked a change in policy toward the mentally ill and handicapped. Hitler himself signed a secret order to start putting them to death. Reinhard Spitze had heard him give his reasons.
And he said, why should we spend money for a fool, for a hopeless, ill person, if I can do with the same money so much good for a poor peasant's kid.
The decision brought the reality of racial policy home to countless ordinary families with a sick relative.
Meine Mutter ist im Dezember 31.
In December 1931, my mother had been sent to the clinic for nervous diseases in Frankfurt am Main because of depression and anxiety about her husband.
Marie Rau's mother was eventually diagnosed as an incurable schizophrenic. Without her family's knowledge, she was brought to the Hadamar Psychiatric Clinic, which became a center for killing the mentally disabled. They were led to the cellar and killed with carbon monoxide gas, up to 60 at a time, over 10,000 in Hadamar alone. Next door was a crude operating slab where brains and other organs were removed for scientific research. The Rows were told their mother had died of complications from warts on her lip. They only learned the truth years later.
The fact that these people were murdered is a disgrace for our whole society.
Some Germans dared to protest publicly against the so-called euthanasia. The gassing was stopped, but killing by injection and starvation continued secretly. As the war went on, the Nazis moved against the Jews in country after country and forced them to wear Stars of David as identification. In Poland, the process of human destruction began when the Jews were confined to ghettos. Bricked off from the outside world, the ghettos were filled to bursting and ridden with disease and hunger. In Warsaw, the Germans allowed themselves 2,300 calories a day. The Poles got about 1,000. Inside the ghetto walls, the ration for the Jews was 183 calories. This was forced starvation. A total of 600,000 died in the ghettos of Greater Germany. Jews worked if they could. They hoped that by making themselves indispensable to the German war economy, they might survive. Even some senior Nazis wondered if Germany shouldn't win the war before dealing with the Jews. But Berlin wasn't prepared to wait. More and more Jews were deported. Stuttgart, Germany, December 1941. 1,000 Jews from the city were given a last meal. They were advised to take tools and cooking pots and told they were going east for resettlement. Aryan Germans could not fail to notice what was happening all over the Third Reich. Peter Bielenberg had actively resisted the Nazis for 8 years, since his days as a law student. He viewed the deportation of the Jews with grave misgivings.
My thought was that while they were fit, and in as far as they were fit, they would be used as slave labor. And as far as they were not fit, they were probably exposed to cold and starvation and would probably die that way. That indeed meant that I was aware of at least partial elimination of the Jews altogether.
The decision to kill all Jews systematically The final solution had now been made. A sand dune on the Latvian coast at Liebau, 1941. A German naval officer on leave with his own movie camera came across a place where Jews were being executed. As well as killing the local Jews, the Nazis brought thousands of German Jews to Latvia to be shot. The executioners didn't always wait for their victims to be brought to them. Mobile units, Einsatzgruppen, combed the countryside, looking for Jews to kill where they lived. Eišiškė in Lithuania was home to 3,500 Jews. In September 1941, the Germans led them to pits outside the town and ordered them to undress. Zvi Mikhaili was 16 years old.
When we all undressed, when I saw Rabbi Zushi undressed, I thought this was the end. The verses from the Psalms that he recited in our ears. Up to then, I'd been confident that we wouldn't die. And my father was saying, "You will live, don't be afraid. You will live and take revenge." He put his left hand on me. I saw my brother David climbing up on his thigh, so tight. He clung so tight. He didn't let go of him until the last minute. And the shots of the machine gun. There was a mixture of voices, of people crying, and children, and the shots, and the dust. And everything mingled together. I found myself inside the pit. I felt my father give me a push, and then fall on top of me. He covered me. He wanted me to live.
Shootings took place in thousands of towns and villages. Jürgen Kroger was an interpreter for one of the execution squads.
They said the Jews were an inferior race. One of them said to me, "It's like having a rose bush, and the rose bush has got green fly on it. Then you have to get rid of the green fly." The Jews weren't human beings for them. It was like killing flies. Killing people wasn't nice work, as they said themselves, but it was necessary work.
Ordinary Germans weren't told about the methods of the final solution, but the goal was stated in public. A Hanover newspaper in 1942 carried the heading, "The Jews to be exterminated." Hitler was quoted as saying, "Whatever this fight brings with it, this will be its final result." Jews were transported from all over occupied Europe. Hans Margulis had fled from Berlin. Caught by the Germans in Holland, he was forced to help with the deportations.
At 6 in the morning, we had to fetch the people who were on the transport lists.
We had to get them. And if they couldn't walk, we had to take them on stretchers to the trains.
It was clear from the destination board that the train was going to Auschwitz. But he didn't know what Auschwitz was.
No one had any idea that there were extermination camps. Otherwise, there would have been a panic, and the process wouldn't have gone so smoothly. Here, people are saying goodbye. Some are on the outside. They're saying, we'll see each other again soon. The war won't last long. That's me. We had to shut the doors. The SS stood behind me and gave the orders. It was very difficult to say no. How could people in our position oppose an SS man?
German state railways charged the SS for transporting the Jews, using the third-class group travel rate. Return tickets for the guards. One way for the Jews. The journey to the camps could take days. No sanitation, no food, little or no water. Many died on the way. When we arrived, we didn't know where we were. We suspected this was a place of death. We saw those chimneys. We saw the smoke from the chimneys. The sight made you shudder. This was going to be our fate. The camps were at the end of the line. Auschwitz in southern Poland was the largest. On the ramp between the tracks, new arrivals were divided into columns of men and women. Then a doctor selected those strong enough to work. The rest were to die immediately. Dora Schwartz and a group of mothers and children was sent on to the gas chamber.
I was lucky. After the selection, another official saw me and pointed for me to go with the others, with the ones who were allowed to live. Because those mothers with children were immediately sent to the ovens. And so I passed from death to life.
The SS photographed the selection of prisoners at Auschwitz during one day in 1944. Work squads of prisoners unloaded the wagons and sorted the belongings. Norbert Lopper from Vienna was a prisoner working on the ramp.
These people were all sick and couldn't walk. We had to help them onto the lorries. They were then transported to the gas chambers. We had a trainload of children arrive from Theresienstadt. They had nurses with them. I can still remember how every child was holding a bread roll. And as they walked past, they had to leave their rolls in a basket. And they went hand in hand with the nurses into the gas chambers.
Hans Munk served as an SS doctor at Auschwitz. He refused to make selections, but he took part in the gassing of Jews just once. First, the chamber doors were closed.
It was almost hermetically sealed. You could hardly hear anything.
Then the Zyklon B gas was thrown in from the top, and the doctor, and on that occasion I took part, had to check after about 10 minutes to see if it was all over. There was a peephole there. You looked through the peephole, and if everyone was on the floor, then it was all right. Then the doors on the side closest to the crematoria were opened. Lorries drove up to take them away more easily.
A photograph taken secretly by a prisoner shows the burning of bodies in the open air. So overworked were the Auschwitz crematoria in the summer of 1944. There were millions of victims of Nazi atrocities, but the biggest group by far was the 6 million Jews systematically killed because they didn't fit in with Germany's racial plan. 500,000 gypsies were killed for the same reason.
We couldn't work it out, why they did it. Why they treated us so badly and were so vicious. We couldn't understand it at all.
Insgesamt aber können wir sagen, wir haben diese schwerste Aufgabe in Liebe zu unserem Volk getan. Und wir haben keinen Schaden in unserem Innern, in unserer Seele, in unserem Charakter daran genommen.
As the war ended, the true cost of the Nazi delusion of a special racial destiny was exposed. As the camps were liberated, the local Germans were brought in. For 12 years, they'd sung the rousing songs, been stirred by their leaders' rhetoric, and shared the glow of early military success. Now they could see the price, the corpses, the medical experiments, the lampshades made of human skin, the result of the attempt to create a master race.
Visit the People's Century website at PBS Online. Add your story to People's Century. Hear more from people featured in tonight's program. And access key events through an interactive timeline. All this and more at PBS.org.
Video cassettes of People's Century are available for educational use. To order, call PBS Video at 1-800-328-PBS. PBS One.
a production of WGBH Boston.
Brought to you by Conseco, where we believe that leaping at certain financial opportunities can make a secure financial future harder to grasp. Conseco, our goal is to help you protect wealth, create wealth for life.
Major funding for People's Century was provided by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and the annual financial support of viewers like you. Additional funding was provided by the Lowell Institute.
This is History's Best on PBS.